Tokyo. And thank you for coming to this event, Love and Passion. My name is Yasue Kobe. Today is your MC. 本日の司会を務めさせていただきます、神戸康江です。どうもよろしくお願いします。Susan?Rockefeller and David Rockefeller Jr. Please. So today's theme is love and passion. Let me tell you why we chose this theme.Too often at these events, we all talk about politics, finance, business. For example, this weekend, we held the third Pan-Asia alumni event in Hong Kong. And the theme was heavily dominated by these topics. Yet, as human being, we also experience emotions.Happiness, sadness, excitement, and fear. So we chose to name this event Love and Passion. Love, because we all love NYU. Passion, because of course we are all passionate to organize exciting events for gathering NYU alumni all together.But more importantly, we love our planet and we are passionate ensuring an environment of our future generation, for our future generations. Susan and David share this passion. This is why I'm so excited that they can join us.This evening to share some of their activities they are engaging. Today, there are two big challenging events going on in this world. One is US presidential election, like all we know. We're just one day before the result. Can't wait to see who is going to be the president.I'm sure most of you have your preferred candidate. So let me ask you, so hands up for Trump? No? No one? Hands up for Trump? Maybe you? Maybe. Okay, you support Trump? Okay. So, then you're joking, okay. Okay. Hands up for Clinton. Okay. So many. And another challenge is RNL today. Can you really pronounce Rockefeller right? As we all know, for Japanese, it is so difficult to pronounce R and L because we don't have this pronunciation in Japanese. Rockefeller start R and finish with R. In the middle, we have to pronunciate two L's.So the combination of R and L, so I had to practice a lot. So let's see. Let's pronounce together Rockefeller. Please, who can pronounce right? Rockefeller, is that right?
Yeah.
Yes? Yes? So in Japanese, we say Rockefeller. like this is a mic. So it's iPhone, same, but Rockefeller is it something in Japanese. So let's pronounce Rockefeller, please.
Rockefeller.
Great, again, please, again. Is that right? Everybody is okay. So I'm honored to announce our guest, Susan. I'm not going to pronounce Rockefeller again, but Susan and David. Very warm welcome. So let's introduce about Susan and David a little bit. Susan is the founder and CEO of Protect What Is Precious, a company that uses the power of documentary filmmaking, photography, storytelling, and design to inspire awareness and mobilize action across a wide range of environmental, social, and philanthropic, that's difficult one, groups. David Rockefeller Jr., chairman of Rockefeller and Corporation, is an active participant in the nonprofit area, especially in the area of environment. David is a trustee of trustee of the Museum of Modern Art and the Asian Cultural Council. He is a fellow of American Academy of Arts and Sciences and a member of the Council on Foreign Relations. Let me also introduce Iue-san, president of Sailors for the Sea Japan. Welcome.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much for inviting us all for such a beautiful evening. My name is Monica, a friend of David and Susan. I proudly introduce my dearest friend Susan Rockefeller and David Rockefeller Jr. for you. David and Susan have been traveling to Japan every year, past 10 years, and every time we travel together to the beautiful part of Japan, and through those experiences that I can tell you that how much that they love Japan and how much they try to investigate a beautiful part of our nation, which I'm really appreciated. And Susan and I have been talking about the ocean conservation through our kitchen talk that we've been connected online and from my kitchen and from Susan's kitchen that we've been chatting to each other and how better we can make this world and how better we can make this earth to pass on to the next generation. We both are the mothers of two children and raising up and ended up to be a part of our bringing up our children as a theme of ocean environment issue is very close to our day-to-day life. And since 2009, Susan made up her own brand, Susan Rockefeller, which you're going to see at the entrance site that we introduced the jewelries and chocolates and more to inspire people throughout the products to give the message of ocean conservation. And also, since 2011, David has been leading the ocean conservation organization called Sailors for the Sea since 2004 in the United States, and we set up the Japan branch in 2011. And ever since, we've been throwing the reception every year. And the first year, I remember that we tried to fill the small space with the 70 people. And now this year, I think we will count 350 people to come to our reception. It's expanding. And I would like to appreciate your cooperation to support us and join us for this beautiful cause, the ocean environmental conservation. And thank you very much. And please listen to the Susan Rockefeller. Thank you.
So I think we're going to, is this the mic that works?
Yeah.
So we're going to, welcome. And it's great to see so many of you here tonight. And I first want to thank Kosei-san for setting this up, and Ms. Kobe, as well as Shinichi-san for organizing this evening. What I'd like to do is just show you a quick 6-minute video, which is going to start right now. And this will showcase some of the work that I've done in film. And then I can start my presentation.
So what inspires me is protecting what is precious, and what that means to me is my family, art, and nature.
We all said years ago that we wanted our food fast, convenient, and cheap, and that's what we expected farmers to supply. Even our Secretary of Agriculture said that farmers had to learn to get bigger, get out. Energy is over. We're depleting our freshwater resources, our soil health, and we got to add climate change into the equation. And then, of course, you have to ask the whole question about human health.
We need to preserve the health of the soil if we are going to preserve our own health.
There are those who deem me an outlaw because I say what I don't see.
It means giving power back to farmers to breed their own varieties for their own regions.
We need to become closer to what a particular place is demanding that we grow, and then we have to cook with it.
Here right now is the cutting edge of a new movement forward in the public becoming more aware of what they eat and where it comes from.
Farmers market, farm stand, community-owned grocery stores, food carts, food delivery trucks, urban farms, vertical farms, restaurants, bakeries, all contracting with one another.
I want us all to become evolutionary, renegade, gangster guard. Get gangster with yourself and let that be your weapon of choice.
There is, in fact, a sense that this could be the beginnings of a kind of revolution within the food system.
When I was a child, I'd hunker down, squinting, trying to spot the fin of a dolphin, the spout of a whale, and even the glorious iridescent tail of a mermaid. I was captivated by their mystery, part human, part fish, the bridge between both worlds I loved. But now that I am grown, I know the truth. Humans have brought this once boundless ocean to the verge of collapse. Fish and the ecosystem that we all depend on for survival. Our oceans are not beyond repair. Each of us must act now so that together we can save our oceans and all that is wild. Dive in.
It says in the Talmud that he who saves one life saves the entire world. And this is really what I'm personally trying to do. The there's 80 million people in Ethiopia, and there's a whole bunch of people, you know, thousands if not millions, who need some sort of medical care. And I can't address all of this, but every time I help one kid, and I straighten their back and straighten out their life and send them to school or treat somebody for cancer, I just feel great. And for me, this is saving a world, which is going to grow up and create a new world. Honestly? Daddy and Mommy? I worked in Ethiopia in the famine in 84, 85. I was very much interested in trying to figure out how I could make at least a small difference in the third world. I think what I would tell young American doctors is to try to think about doing something a bit different. Follow your heart.
To come on a tour like this and deliberately leave all of the politics at home. That's what's so awesome about music is it's this connection with other people.
I don't want to be labeled having this stigma, so I just came on my show.
I gave him a mask and zoned out into the drawing. And for me, it just released the block.
There is a growing body of evidence showing the arts can really be of value to alleviating symptoms of stress, of traumatic brain injury, of depression.
Now that I got the therapy, I know MDMA can help, if not cure, some symptoms. I think it's truly important that we don't have anything off the table for our veterans.
That not everything has to be a therapeutic event. There is room for joy.
And part of being a mom is thinking about the health of my children and the health of the planet and the things that sustain us. Life is short and we want to make a difference while you're here. So I just thought that I'd start with that just to give you a background of the sort of expansive subject matters that I think about and that I use film to sort of engage a larger and broader audience. So tonight I thought I would talk about three things: the power and influence of NYU, to tell you how NYU affected my life, and to talk about the power of how one individual can make a difference in the world. So when preparing for this conversation, I was curious about the scope of the NYU alumni network in Japan, and I was pleased to find out that Japan has over 3,000 alumni, which I'm sure you know, and is one of the largest alumni populations in all of Asia. So I'm thrilled to meet so many of you and see, I hope later during the banquet, we can spend some time talking, but it's great to see that there's so many people here and that you're using this this space and using the alumni network to just come together and talk about ideas that are of global significance. So in September, I think you all know that we celebrated the inauguration of NYU's 16th president, Andrew Hamilton. I'm sure you all are aware of that. And President Hamilton talked about two of his top priorities at his inauguration, which was diversity and affordability, and that our actions as an institution alone are insufficient and must be matched by something both less tangible and more profound. And he talks about a change in culture, outlook, understanding, and respect. Hamilton additionally said that each of us must encourage an openness to the perspective of others and a personal commitment to create a better, more inclusive, and equitable NYU community. So I personally love this message in a world where global leadership and understanding is so crucial for a more sustainable and peaceful future. David and I love our time coming to Asia, and being here with the NYU alumni adds another dimension of deeper understanding and connection. So again, many thanks for organizing this tonight. So I wanted to give you a quick update on our alma mater. I don't know if I just was, this was given to me by a mentor of mine at NYU, and I was really amazed to hear about these statistics, that NYU received more than 63,000 applicants for admission to this year's class of 2020. In fact, more students applied to NYU than any other private university in America. I had no idea. I don't know if you did know that, but I think it's very impressive. And I think this can give us more confidence in NYU's growing influence and robust global network. So the question now is, how do we ensure that this alumni network remains relevant in a changing world and achieves more than simply the sum of its parts? So what may be of utmost importance? David and I believe that there's never been a more urgent time now for bold action for global business, education, and environmental sustainability. In the face of destructive public discourse on immigration in the United States, suspicion of entire religions and ethnic groups, and a range of problems that defy borders, from climate change to ideological extremism, it is essential that we choose not to retreat, but to engage together. And with this thought, we are hoping, and I'm glad to hear that so many of you are hoping, that tomorrow we will have the first female president of the United States of America. So I wanted to say a few words about who I am and the career path that brought me to where I am today, and how following your passion and love and pursuing lifelong learning as a shared value is crucial for helping to live a life with purpose and meaning. I grew up in Larchmont, New York. It's a suburb of New York City. And my mother was an anthropologist and taught anthropology at Sarah Lawrence College, which is also in New York. And my father was a businessman, a conservationist, and passionate about the history and philosophy of science and ideas. And incidentally, he also went to NYU and received his MBA there. So it runs in the family a bit. As a child, I loved exploring nature, and our family spent summers by the ocean on the eastern end of Long Island, which is now branded as the Hamptons, which I'm sure many of you have been to, and also winter vacation skiing in Vermont. So nature has always been a source of inspiration for me, and I pursued that passion and that love of nature in college, where I studied environmental studies, ecological horticulture, and photography. So following graduation, I sort of ended up following in my mother's footsteps as an anthropologist, and I journeyed off to Alaska to live with the Inuit, the Eskimo, and expanded my understanding of subsistence living and the extreme and beautiful wildness of the Arctic landscape. After living with the Inuit off and on for 3 years, learning about indigenous culture and doing work in community gardening and fisheries, I came back to New York to figure out my next step. I went from the Arctic wilderness to the concrete jungle of New York City. Both wilderness and urban environments nurture my creativity and sense of being a global citizen and a citizen of planet Earth. So I was deciding at this time whether to get my MBA at NYU or a master's in counseling education with a focus on economic development and environmental sustainability. I ended up doing a master's in education because I was given a full scholarship and I had a great graduate assistantship with the Dean of Students of the Education School, Patricia Carey, who has been my mentor and continues to be a really close friend. Once I completed my master's at NYU, I went on to the Stern School of Business. I'm sure many of you maybe went to the Stern School. I don't know, raise of hands. Many of you, yeah. And I created, I might have been there when you were there. I don't know, we'll have to find out. But created conferences on work and environmental sustainability and corporate social responsibility and conferences on women's issues in the workplace. I also wrote 3 books when I was at the Stern School of Business. Green at Work, Finding a Business Career That Works for the Environment, that was published in 1992 and 1995, and also Finding Your Way with an MBA. So NYU was a place where I could incubate ideas and take time to synthesize and write about them as well. So it was a wonderful time, and I loved being able to communicate my knowledge and my vision through the written word, but I missed my photography and my art. So I decided to combine my writing skills and my passion for photography to segue into film and pursue visual storytelling. I ended up working with 2 filmmakers on my first film, both of whom went to NYU Tisch School of the Arts. So they mentored me and they provided me with a great introduction to the world of filmmaking. So again, a thread of NYU and its role in my career development, which I wasn't actually thinking about until I wrote the speech this morning. I was thinking, NYU is really significant, and I hadn't taken the time to think about the different aspects of how it's influenced me. So today I'm founder and CEO of Protect What Is Precious, and I use the power of documentary filmmaking, photography, storytelling, and design to inspire awareness. It is my mission and my passion to use artistic means to raise awareness and ignite conversations about the causes that are dear to my heart and the issues that impact us all. On an aside, but a deeply significant aside, I met David when we collaborated on a film on Alaska. David narrated the script, and also wrote the script, and I put the words and the images to music, and the images and the music to his words and his narration. So for me, art continues to be a great muse that connects us all, and it is a universal language. And David and I continue to work together on film projects and collaborate together in areas around healthy soils and healthy seas. So I believe that telling stories is key to creating a narrative about our common future. So I write, I make films, and I co-brand with companies to engage a global audience in taking action. So given the fast-paced world that we live in, I went from making feature films at 90 minutes to 60-minute films, down to 40-minute for HBO and other networks, and then down to 15-minute that had corporate sponsorship, and now I'm down to 1-minute videos to provide insight and solutions to complex problems through social media. So I'll show those later in a bit, but I'm personally committed to spreading the awareness about protecting what is precious. And for David and me, those pillars are family, art, and nature. And making sure that in this fast-paced world, we take time to rest, rejuvenate, and reimagine a world, as NYU President Hamilton expressed so eloquently, that allows us to engage and work together for a more resilient and inclusive way that respects culture and our global environment. So for us, this means that we need everyone to play their part. So no matter what field you're in, you can always apply an environmental or socially responsible lens to your work, whether you're in writing, a designer, a business person. There's ways that you can implement traceability and environmental responsible practices. So we were thinking about this talk this afternoon, and I realized that speaking out as an individual is not as much the tradition in Japanese culture as it is in the United States. But David and I have noticed changes over our 10 years of being here together. Perhaps the global dialogue about sustainability is creating opportunity for everyone to take part, men and women alike. The United Nations Sustainable Development Goals are a global platform for sustainability and innovation for global NGOs, governments, and global businesses. It will be one of the biggest investments of the coming decades, and we will see some of the biggest returns. The opportunities for businesses to adopt a sustainable lens is enormous. Governments tend to be falling short a bit, and the global crisis we are facing is not as much financial or economic as it is moral. So humanity needs to get us out of this, and each one of us can make a difference. So sustainability is about taking a long-term view. If our air, water, and fish are not healthy, we can get sick and we can't be productive. So there's an economic interest in health and the well-being of ourselves and the planet. So we must seek to create balance between growing our economy and taking care of the environment. And those are the questions that David and I spend a lot of time thinking about pretty much every day. So sustainable principles can also be applied to your career as well. Patience, persistence, and the ability to pivot with the times that necessitate that we adapt when necessary. So I'd like to also touch upon my nonprofit work that falls under Protect What Is Precious, and that is the mantra that David and I use to focus much of our philanthropic efforts. I sit on the board of Oceana and the board of Stone Barn Center for Food and Agriculture. So if you're ever back in New York visiting NYU, you could go up to Tarrytown and see the farm, the Stone Barn Center. And I've chosen to align with these organizations because they're working to heal and protect our land, our oceans, and ultimately our future food systems for humanity. Our oceans cover 70% of the globe. They are home to most of the life on our planet and feed over 3 billion people worldwide. Oceana has a campaign to save the oceans and feed the world. We work country by country to help enforce fishing regulations, minimize bycatch or waste, and protect fish habitat. We've also just launched Global Fishing Watch with Google to create a safe oceans network and have better surveillance on industrial vessels to make sure we can protect countries from illegal, unreported, and unregulated fishing. David and I had the pleasure of being at the Our Ocean Conference in Washington, D.C. when this wonderful program was launched, and I'd like to show you a brief one-minute video of Leonardo DiCaprio announcing Global Fishing Watch with all of you so that you may be able to share in the experience as well.
Hi, I'm Susan Rockefeller, and I'm on a path to lead with love and protect what is precious.
This conference has become a true platform for action on how much our climate, food security, economic security, and ultimately our future on this planet depends on the health of our oceans. I encourage everyone to go check out globalfishingwatch.org. This platform will empower citizens across the globe to become powerful advocates for our oceans. With the data Global Fishing Watch provides governments, fishery management organizations, researchers, and the fishing industry can work together to rebuild fisheries and protect critical marine habitats.
So that will go out. I have these one-minute videos that go out on social media, and I'll be sharing them with Minako for Sailors for the Sea, so they could go out as well. So stay tuned for those. And with Stone Barns, we work on healthy soils, eliminating food waste, and educating the next generation farmers and the public on the future of food. So I'm going to show one more one-minute video on the Future of Food Conference at Stone Barns, where innovators in the global food space talked about solutions for feeding a rapidly growing population. This is just a teaser, and then there'll be more that I'll be giving to Minako to put up on Sailors for the Sea Japan.
Hi, I'm Susan Rockefeller. I am here at Stone Barn Center for Food and Agriculture with the New York Times Food for Tomorrow conference.
Can you just tell us quickly what we're having?
Hot dogs. I bought from a field to your late fast.
How do we create a whole new
set of ingredients that not only withstand the challenges of the future, but do it deliciously.
Television allows us to sort of broaden our language about food.
And if we are going to feed this planet sustainably, we have to find new solutions.
For me, this sort of farming is the gateway drug of an entirely new cuisine.
We have interviewed some fantastic people.
Kind of connect the dots now between the classroom and the cafeteria, and have learning about food by growing themselves.
So stay tuned. We're super excited to continue on the journey to lead with love and protect what is precious.
So, on an aside, David and I are working hard in upstate New York on a farm. We have about 1,200 acres that we have converted from conventional soil to organic. So the issues facing agriculture, you know, you can talk about it, but it's really hard to make it work. And that's what we're trying to do. So we both work with organizations, but also really work to practice in our own work. The experimentation and working to see how we can improve farming practices in our local region, the Hudson Valley. So again, if you're ever in the Hudson Valley, we're happy to show you what we're doing because it's innovative and very exciting. But again, it takes a lot of work and a lot of patience. So agriculture is one of the greatest polluters globally, and runoff from the fertilizers and the chemicals impact our aquatic ecosystems and in turn our human health. So it's all interconnected, and that's why David and I work to protect that delicate relationship between healthy soils and healthy seas, because much of the fertilizers and the chemicals drain into the rivers and end up in the oceans and create dead zones. And you know, just making the connections between what goes on land and also its effects with the ocean and the health of the ocean is key. So to get information on some of this, you can go to my website, but also MinMin can provide these links as well with Japanese subtitles, Minako, and you can learn what fish are good to eat by using the Sailors for the Sea Blue Seafood Guide, which I think you all got copies of. And both Sailors for the Sea Japan and Protect What is Precious have offices in Yokohama and Ashiya. And I'm hoping that Minako can talk about and touch upon those in conversation during the question and answer period. So David and Minako and I work very hard with Sailors for the Sea to help raise awareness about what's happening in our oceans. And I'm really grateful to the work of Sailors for the Sea because it, on a local level, allows you to understand what fish are healthy to eat and the importance that you can actually vote with your fork or your chopstick 3 times a day. You can make a difference with the choices you make. So, and also the Susan Rockefeller store, which Minako is also managing, has products that really inspire a life that celebrates the land and the ocean and the beauty of being in balance with ourselves and the earth. So I just wanted to add a few more general thoughts about our visits to Japan. Japan, as you know, is an island nation involved in both fisheries and agriculture. And we all have an important role in making strides to create safe ecological food systems and to protect the harmony between land and sea and the harmony between cultures and nations. We love visiting Japan because of its profound elegance. We see it in its simplicity and brilliance in design, the philosophy of wabi-sabi, the floral practice of ikebana, in the beauty of the paintings and the calligraphy, the beauty of the gardens that we've visited, and the attention to detail in almost everything that we see in this country. So when we come to Japan, we end up combining business and time to see your country. And in doing this, we find time to sort of calm down, because we're super busy, and pay attention, and to rest, and to rejuvenate, and to reimagine a world where we actually have time to be in the silence, and to feel the mystery and the beauty of being alive. And what's so wonderful for us is that all the noise disappears and we can ask ourselves, what does it mean? What does it mean to be human? And what is my role on this earth? And for me, it's a constant mystery and it's always humbling. And we're here for such a short, short time. And I believe that we all need to cherish these reflective experiences and honor our life journey and work to protect what is precious to each of us. So as I reflect upon my experiences and my education at NYU, I realize that perhaps the greatest skill that I learned was in the art of listening and counseling. And I continue to use these skills with friends, family, and colleagues. And I believe that listening to others is a lost art in the digital age in which we find ourselves. Listening is key to creating deeper understanding and respect in our listening to our own intuitive inklings of the heart, and also in our human interactions and diplomacy between nations. So my hope is that we will all work to protect what is precious, take time to listen, and work toward greater understanding between each other and nations, and add an environmental and socially inclusive lens to the work we do, and to pursue our passions in a way that respects both ourselves and the earth. As our population reaches 9 billion by 2050, our choices and our ways of working together will be key for our own health, our children's health, and for the health of our grandchildren and great-grandchildren. I also believe, and I see so many women here in the audience, that women are fierce protectors of their families. We want to protect our children's health, and we have the purchasing power, and we can lead with the choices that we make each day at the supermarket, what to buy or not to buy. And I also wanted to mention that I understand that you have an environmentally conscious first female governor of Tokyo, Yuriko Koike, which is just so fantastic to know that she's sort of, looking at these issues and really wanting to deepen the sustainability of Tokyo. So it gives me hope that all over the globe, we are all wanting to protect what is precious. We see this. We were just in Beijing. We were in Hong Kong. We were in Nairobi in September, in Chile. We've been traveling a lot. And we're seeing that there is this collective sea change of people that want to protect what they love. And the only way you can protect something is if you love it. So I'm optimistic. I think that the most important thing we all can do is to follow our love and our passion. And we believe that love and beauty is so much of the motivator for wanting to save these beautiful ecosystems, both on land and sea. Because without the beauty, without love, without the cultures that are really grown out of love of family, we don't have a reason to protect these resources. So my hope is that we can all work together, the NYU community, and work together to make the world a better place. So I want to leave you with that, and then we can take questions, because I think I've done my 15 or 20 minutes, and look forward to taking questions from all of you. So thank you very much.
Thank you, and Susan, that was beautiful. Such good words and good thoughts. It's nice to see you here tonight. And I think I should say very little because a lot was said and we're interested in what is in your minds. Maybe I would just say it has been my pleasure with Susan and Minako-san to build Sailors for the Sea Japan. And over 5 years, we have done a lot. And thank you for considering joining us. It's fun and it's good work. So thank you so much. And I think maybe, Susan, if you come up, then we could answer questions. Yeah?
Okay, now it's question time. So, if you have any questions, raise your hand. I will pass this microphone to you.
First of all, I think on behalf of everyone, I want to thank both of you for coming to Japan and sharing your thoughts and talking about issues that are near and dear to your heart. Susan, I wanted to ask you, because you know, you did mention that initially when you had started working in film, you know, the work you were doing started off 9 minutes and then became 45 and then got shorter and shorter, now 1 minute. I think it kind of speaks to kind of our unfortunate overall, you know, sense of time and how everything, especially in New York, is a New York minute now. But can you talk a bit about, you know, how you choose your topics and what that creative process is like for you? Because I'm sure it must be challenging given all the footage that, and the significance of the issues you're addressing. How do you distill it into, you know, such a short, you know, 60 seconds?
That's a great question. And I also I do continue to do art house cinema. So I do some feature films, both feature documentaries and art house fiction films, but it's under a different company called Louverture Films. So it's a global company and we have partners, and so we continue to do that, but it's not what I spend my time doing. I'll go in on an executive producer, an associate producer role, and look mostly at the editing and really look to edit down whatever films we have in that film company. But in terms of you know, the importance, like what I'm finding is that, especially having young children, they're not that young, but you know, I've got a 16-year-old and a 20-year-old, and they don't spend a lot of time. I mean, you could probably see this with your children. They just kind of click, and if it doesn't grab their attention, they're on to something else. So I want to continue to make sort of the beautiful art, you know, films, because I believe in the reflective moments that take time. But in terms of social media and getting people to watch something, the 1 minute on Instagram is just a very potent way to get information out. So for instance, I did a 1 minute video with Adrien Grenier, who's an actor. He's been on Entourage, and we got over 250,000 hits of people watching it. So if that had been a 15-minute interview, people would not have watched it. Maybe they would have, but I think you get much more stickiness and more views and visibility with the shorter format film. And in terms of content, right now I use the lens of protecting what is precious, which is family, art, and nature. So I do interviews on artists that have a point of view about using art to elevate the issues of our ecological crisis. I interview designers that are using sustainable materials or processes. I do a lot of interviews of people in the food, agriculture space, and the ocean space. So it's really, you know, how do you actually influence people and get these ideas out? But then there's sort of the permeation of ideas that just sort of trickle through reading the newspaper. And I was very interested in the effects of PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, on our military. And also the fact that the issues that are involved in that kind of trauma is not just for those that have been in service, but it's from people that have been abused or have had any kind of trauma in their lives. And that particular film has gone on to have a lot of use in conferences and medical institutions with people that are working with veterans and working with trauma. So really, it's just, I think about something, I think, is there something that hasn't been said? Is there something that's important to be said? And the film on the doctor in Ethiopia went on to air on HBO, and David and I went to Ethiopia, and I had heard about this man, and we were going over to Uganda for Rockefeller Foundation meetings, and I said, let's just stop in Ethiopia and interview him and go to the Mother Teresa mission where he was doing his work. And then it ended up going on to HBO and winning some awards. And so I think that you have to, again, it gets back to the love and passion that if I'm going to do something, it takes so much time to do something well that I actually have to love the idea and be passionate about it, because by the end, I don't actually see much of my films. You know, I end up being much more interested in like a still photograph that kind of distills the essence of what I was trying to say. So I still do photography, and I look at the moving image, and then I usually take one or two photographs that really exemplify what I'm interested in. But there's a lot of ideas, and I tend to focus on the ocean space, the agricultural space, and then anything having to do with sustainability in the fashion space as well, because it is related to agriculture.
Any other question?
Thank you for your great presentation. My name is Hideo Rubio. I'm a state senator in Yamanashi Prefecture. Mount Fuji. So I have really simple questions, like what we can do for us as Japanese people. I mean, you told me to us, like, you visit Japan many times. I mean, you know Japan more than other foreigners. I mean, probably that you feel like very unique things like Japanese tradition and culture and really way of thinking, and probably really unique you feel period. Yeah. I feel like probably the difference and diversity can make the world better, I feel. So what we can do for the climate change, and then what we can do then as a Japanese, probably you know the Montainai. Do you know the Montainai, the Japanese was, and like really like we, it's from the probably Edo period, like we feel like things like it's really difficult to explain. By the way, sorry. my question is like, how do you feel? Like, how do you think Japanese are like, our unique cultures like can help the world or better the world?
Okay. So I think from a design standpoint, and we just went to the 2121 Museum, and they have this fantastic exhibition on design anatomy. And I think that so much of what's going to be going on and fueling design innovation is something called the circular economy, and designing not for obsolescence, but for the future and having things that will last a long time. And I think so much of the design in Japan is brilliant. And it's long-lasting and has an endurance of quality and an essence of craftsmanship that I think is becoming more of a trend globally. So globally, there's a lot of online platforms that are trying to bring local artisans around the world to a portal, right? Like whether it's Etsy or, you know, other online platforms where people want to buy something where they can feel that it's been handmade, that it's not part of a, you know, production line, and it's not a mass-produced item. So I think that the Japanese ingenuity and design, the intelligence of the design here is something that I would look to. And then just in terms of innovation on the business side, just looking at how you can innovate. I mean, there's been so much innovation in Japan as an island nation, from agriculture to business, that, you know, looking at how you can actually make a difference in your day-to-day business operations. But I think design is really key, a key component to bringing the beauty and the beauty of design to the world, because I think that this country is extraordinary. We spend a lot of time just in awe of the gardens and, you know, all the elements that make your culture so deep and profound. So I think you're very fortunate. I guess, you know, to continue doing what you're doing and not to bring in, you know, I mean, we're struck by the fact that you don't have all the fast food. You have actually, you know, in each meal that we have, there's a beauty in the way things are presented and an attention to detail. And I think most of, much of the world has lost that in the acceleration of industrial development. So to just remember the importance of the beauty and the culture here.
Sure. So I have quite a different answer to that. I agree with Susan's answer, but I would add that I think the issue of transparency about information is very important worldwide, but I know it's also important in Japan. That transparency of if something goes wrong, what happened? And let's get the truth out and not hide behind embarrassment to discover the truth. So whether it's about nuclear power or about food safety or about fisheries management, there are so many things where it's important for the public to get the facts and believe in the facts, and of course, important for government to research the facts and tell the public honestly what the facts are, even if they are uncomfortable, because if the facts are true and they're causing people to be ill, it's the responsibility of government and corporations and all of us to speak out. And actually, Japan has a wonderful tradition of apology. So I think you have some advantages in that. But this is not just a Japanese problem, of course. It's a global problem. And I think the more that we have transparency and the more that good science, especially, is maybe through art put in clear form so that people can understand very complicated things, because the world is a complicated place socially, economically, biologically, etc. So that would be my answer. It's not only an answer to the Japanese people, but I think to everybody, including ourselves, of course, in the US.
Very good.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Very good. Thank you very much. You are, I think, you're already very thirsty and hungry, so it's time to the beverage. So thank you very much. Yes, before we, please stay, we are taking group photo.
Oh.
Saito-san. Yeah, we are taking photos. So Susan, David, please take a seat.
Okay.
Photographer over here, take all of you. Please. This is very nice.
Thank you.
I'm very proud to have this special event with all you guys this time, because we never know Susan and David is very close to NYU, but because of Kobayashi-san, he's the guy actually connected Rockefeller family to NYU in Japan. Thank you very much. And we really hope that you come back next year and we'd like to have this type of event as a regular event, if you don't mind. And we'd like to enlarge these groups more and more. Because as Susan presented, NYU alumni are globally very active, try to be more active than any other major universities. NYU brand is not so high, but my hope is to raise NYU brand more, even talk to the world. And as you might know, the NYU has campus in Shanghai and Abu Dhabi, other than New York. And what NYU is very smart buying schools. They are merging acquisition other schools. Recently, they bought one in junior school in Brooklyn. And NYU has now campus in Brooklyn. You might be surprised. This is the NYU. And also, don't forget, NYU has franchise operation in Tokyo. This is Shinagawa NYU SPS campus. This is dedicated by Nichigakan, and thanks to Nichigakan's support, we have this nice facility here. So we always use this place free of charge because they are family, and we get to contribute back to SPS. This is my promise. So thank you very much, and I'd like to make final two remarks. We have another event in December 1st, Thursday, next month. This is a 2016 EIN reception. This is a regular event that we are hosting everybody. And if you, even though you are not NYU alumni, we are very welcome because we are borderless and we like to enlarge and we like to welcome everybody to this event. Just a bit of essence of December event is that we have a panel discussion among very famous commentators and lawyers and politicians. We cannot name you now, but probably you can follow Facebook page. Next week we can probably announce the panelists. And also there will be a small mini concert performed by Miki Miyamoto. She is a very famous singer these days because she was number one champion of 2016 Karaoke Battle, which is the TV Tokyo program in my home. She's very, very, very good, and please listen to her singing, just 30 minutes or 40 minutes. She's a friend of mine, so I just invited her to make a small concert for us. And another good event, well, event, significant event next year is we are hosting Pan-Asia Alumni Conference in Tokyo in December. By the way, Pan-Asia Conference, Pan-Asia Alumni is part of NYU Alumni Networking in Asia, and we are having conference every year across all Asia, starting with Taiwan, Shanghai this year, a couple of days ago in Hong Kong, and next year we invite them to Tokyo. So please keep this in your mind, and we will try to make announcement very, very soon, and hope you guys gather again. We try to have much bigger event, and we can meet any other alumni from all over Asia, from China, Hong Kong, Taiwan, Korea, Thailand, Philippines, India. So we like to mix even more, even larger countries across all Asia. This is NYU's activity these days. And really, thank you very much for coming, and we try to go.